All right, showtime. You ready?
Born ready.
Great. Did you bring the dongle?
What's a dongle?
Never mind. We'll just show him on your laptop.
I was supposed to bring my laptop?
Don't panic. You shared the presentation with me, right?
I forgot.
Well, if you log in, then we can...
My password. I was about to say I forgot my password.
You ordered the food through Easy Cater, right?
Yes.
We'll be fine.
Food can make or break a presentation, so make sure you order at EasyCater.com. Individually packaged food, delivered right on time. How? Easy Cater.
Dealing with adversity and finding ways to unify and overcome it will always be part of our future. The new season of Hope Through History, a documentary podcast presentation from C13 Originals in association with the History Channel, written and narrated by me, John Meacham, features moments in our nation's past when we faced challenges as a country and as a world. Listen and follow Season 2 of Hope Through History, available now wherever you get your podcasts.
Well, this guy has just hundreds and hundreds of 1K contracts with our great company. He's our Browns beat reporter. He earns every bit of that. Daryl Ryder joining us on the North Olmsted Chrysler Jeep Dodge Ram Hotline. His reports, as always, powered by Scheiben Jewelers, Cleveland's premier jewelry store. Daryl, how are you, sir?
Wait, I got a raise and no one told me?
You know how Andy's sneaky like that. April Fool's. Oh, wait, we weren't allowed to do any April Fool's jokes. My fault.
And thank goodness. That might have been the best management decision we've ever made as a radio station.
Did I ever tell – I'm going to have to tell this story. I don't know if – yeah, I can do it now. Hell. So Roth calls me like a few years ago. I don't even know if he remembers this. And it's on April Fool's. I'm not even thinking it's April Fool's. I'm not even really paying attention. And he goes, so what's going on for tonight? Because I was filling in. This is years ago. And I'm like, I don't know. I mean, you mean like the show? And he's like, yeah. And I'm like, well, I don't know. Tournament's going on and free agency, draft's coming up. And he's like, and what else is going on? I'm like, Andy, I can't think of anything. And he's like, exactly, nothing. And I'm like, Andy, I'm not following you. And he's like, it's April Fool's Day, which means you'll be doing nothing in the form of April Fool's jokes. I'm like, Andy, that is one of the most circuitous routes you've ever taken to telling me not to do an April Fool's joke. And he did it. Why am I calling? So it was vintage Roth. Vintage Roth.
Very nice.
Not to do very the nice April Fool's jokes. All right.
Yeah, they're just the older I get, they're just no longer funny to me.
No, I totally agree. And, like and the, you know like what?
I think it's because we got all these, you know, fake accounts on Twitter these days, right?
Yeah.
That, you know, put out all the legitimately, you know, fake news pretending to be Schefter, Woj, or whatever. So I think that's there. We get April Fool's Day, like, almost every day. So, yeah, part of it might be me getting older and grumpier. I totally acknowledge that. And you know what? I'm completely fine with getting older and grumpier.
I'm not, although I am getting older and grumpier. I'm not necessarily okay with that. But I will say this. The April Fool's stuff, like from years ago, like with the radio, you know, growing up as a kid, you're listening to the radio. I mean, some of those were, I can see now why companies are like, no. Because, I mean,
there were some legendary ones over the years. But now in today's world, there are things that we used to do in our business that we can no longer get away with, on or off the air.
Exactly. All right, Daryl Ryder, our Browns beat reporter, joins. So, Daryl, I came up with something about 45 minutes ago that people – we've talked about this, where the Browns are going to go at 26. And I think early on, say 3-4 weeks ago, yeah, you know what? They're probably not going to go linebacker. And maybe they're still not going to go linebacker. But it's starting to pick up steam. Nick Shook last week said, I had a conversation with Daniel Jeremiah. And you don't know, Zaven Collins, Jamin Davis is picking up a lot of steam coming out of Kentucky. And he had a great pro day. And then I had a caller last hour that said, you know, I'm telling you, it's going to be a linebacker, and it seems like the linebacker cult is strong. Like, they are not going – they are not going to – like, defensive end people are like, well, if they grab a corner, I guess I trust Andrew Berry. The people that are dead set on linebackers are not budging off linebackers. So I'll ask you about the linebacker position. Do you think it's picking up steam or would pick up steam for the Browns at 26?
I'll just say the linebacker people must have watched the position last year and probably had the same feeling that Andrew Berry did watching it. So hey, I've been saying for years the Browns need elite linebacker play if they really want to be a Super Bowl contender. I don't think it's a secret that the two teams in the division that have Vince Lombardi trophies in the trophy case this century, they got outstanding play at that position. So I don't know if it's it might be picking up steam amongst the media, but I don't know if it is picking up any additional steam in Andrew Berry's office as far as his evaluation process goes. I think he certainly recognizes it's a need. They did sign Anthony Walker, brought him over from the Colts, but keep in mind that's a 1-year contract. They don't have a lot of long term investment at that particular position. So it'll be best defensive player available, and if it happens to be a linebacker, then that's what it ultimately is going to be. But I think it's the picking up steam stuff, that's kind of it's a media thing. You know what I mean? I don't know that that's an Andrew Berry or Browns or scouting or, draft evaluation thing. I think that they, as we sit here on April 6th, have a pretty good idea what their draft board is going to look like at the end of the month.
Okay, so let's stay at the linebacker position because I think we've done a pretty fair job of, evaluating, hey, what do they have as far as, young guys, defensive ends like that. So we've gone there and we've evaluated the corners and the safeties. Have we really, when you look at Mac Wilson, when you look at Sione Takitaki, when you look at Jacob Phillips, from the time they were drafted to right now as we speak on April the 6th, have you seen a lot of improvement with each of those guys? Have you seen a lot of, we just don't know what we have right now? Like, give us an idea of the guys currently on the roster, what you think of, like I said, Takitaki, Wilson, and Jacob Phillips seems to be a guy that they like a lot as far as that athleticism.
Yeah, I mean, Takitaki made a couple plays there, late in the season. I really like Mac Wilson's lateral movement side to side. If he can learn to tackle, I think he can really be a real nice player. I'd say that's the biggest deficiency, in his game. Jacob Phillips is a youngster that, as you mentioned, that they seem pretty, high on and really want to give opportunity to. Of course, we mentioned they brought in Anthony Walker this offseason. Elijah Lee's another kid that's in that mix. I mean, he's going into his fourth or fifth season, so I guess he's not so much a kid anymore, but to me, he's kind of a kid. Meander, who is kind of volleyed back and forth in and out of the organization from the practice squad to the active roster and all that. He's another young, intriguing type of player. But when you talk about elite play, I don't think that they have that guy on the roster. I think that they have a couple of nice pieces. They with a lot of upside. They brought in some veteran presence and quality. A quality player in Walker, but I still think that there's room to grow within that room to get out of that position group what you want to get if you're going to compete for a Super Bowl. But the cupboard isn't as bare, I guess, as it's perceived to be. But they do have some players that still need to refine their game, most notably, a Takitaki, a Wilson, and Phillips, who we were talking about.
Daryl Ryder, our Browns beat reporter, joining us. Again, his report's powered by Scheiben Jewelers, Cleveland's premier jewelry store. All right, so I think there are some that feel, well, the addition of Hill, who can play slot and can move to the outside. Kevin Stefanski was adamant about pointing that out. Greedy Williams, you hope, is going to come back healthy. I think there might be some that feel like, you know what, corner might be good, but I still think at 26, like, Daryl, it wouldn't shock me. And again, we go with the presumption. We have no idea what's going on in the rooms in Berea, what they're talking about. But J.C. Horn, Caleb Farley, Greg Newsome, like, if one of those guys is available and they like him a lot, I just can't see a situation where a corner wouldn't certainly be in the discussion as well, because if there's one thing we know, you can't have too many pass rushers. You certainly can't have too many corners.
Well, right now, I want to say they have 7 corners on the roster, just off the top of my head. In addition to the guys you mentioned, A.J. Green, they got Troy Hill, Allen, Brian Allen, the kid from Utah. They got him too, and Hill, Troy Hill, and Robert Jackson too. Don't want to forget about him. So they got a lot of names, as far as they got bodies there. But yeah, I mean, your top guys there, Hill, who they brought in, right? Greedy coming back from injury. Denzel Ward has, I think we can agree, is established. Then you're looking at depth behind them, who becomes your dime guy, if someone gets hurt, who can step into a starting role there. I think that when the Browns go on the clock at the end of the month, it's going to be the best defender available, and it doesn't matter where the kid plays. It could be a corner. I still think there's a chance they could take a safety, linebacker we talked about, and I still believe that defensive end is a priority. But you can't just draft by priority. What Andrew Berry did, this offseason in free agency, Chico, is he gave himself the flexibility to go best player available here. So he doesn't have to draft a linebacker or a corner or a defensive end for the sake of, yep, looking at the depth chart, that's what we need, so we need to go ahead and take a player there, because that's usually the wrong way to draft, okay? When you are just strictly drafting by need, you often get yourself into trouble. And so I think that, by him, with the guys that he signed right out of the gate in the first 2 weeks of free agency there, he has given himself the flexibility to go with the best defender available, regardless of what level of the defense that player plays.
Should we basically feel like the Browns are, as far as a guy like Jadeveon Clowney, or for that matter, anybody right now in free agency, that things are kind of on hold? Not to say they're not paying attention, but they're more focused on the draft. Would that be a fair statement to make, Daryl?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's fair to say that their number one priority right now is finalizing their work in preparation for the draft. The pitch is out to Clowney. He's not taking it yet, and that's fine. So no need to bid against yourself, right? So if he comes on board beforehand, or whatever he decides to do, he decides to do. I mean, it's out of the Browns' control anyway. So yeah, I think it's fair to say we got a little over 3 weeks until the draft here in Cleveland. Andrew Berry's got to get that draft board finalized for all 7 rounds. He's got to, project who he thinks might go undrafted and who may be available after round number 7, so they can, get those undrafted rookie free agents lined up as well. So he's got a busy couple of weeks here. He knocked out his free agency work in rather quick fashion. In basically a week's time, he got done what he wanted to get done. I want to say they have around $12 million, between $12 and $14 million in salary cap space. And we deduct from that an $8 million draft signing pool. So the Browns have between $4 and $6 million in salary cap room to bring somebody else in right now.
So we'll let you go with this. I was reading over the weekend the possibility, and you know, Roger Goodell, the NFL, they're always looking for new ways to get their product out there. A midnight madness, kind of like what college basketball has had over the years, where you start the season, your first practice is at midnight. The NFL is toying with that idea. Would you be for or against it? Do you think it's something that is a real possibility for the NFL?
Well, anything is a possibility for the NFL, and I'm against it because that's past my curfew, my bedtime.
Come on, maybe, you're not that old.
I don't know if I can hang past the bars closing anymore.
Well, they'd let you go before last call. They'd let you go around 1:20, grab a cocktail, and then call it a night. So
then you're looking at in bed by 5. I mean, some of the primetime games, right? What, the college national championship started at like 9:30 the other night. I was like half asleep when it ended. It was like I looked at the TV, okay, Baylor won, and 30 seconds later, it was like morning. What happened? I was watching college basketball like 2 seconds ago. Yeah, it's certainly, I'm sure anything's a possibility with the NFL. I would not be a fan of it selfishly just because it would not be great to be doing work at 4 a.m. But, hey, you know what? Browns fan would have some fresh content when they rolled out of bed, first thing in the morning when they wake up, right? Hey, what happened last night at Midnight Madness?
Well, and Browns fans would have no problem taking that midnight practice into the early morning hours.
Could you imagine what it'd be like if that was open to the public in Berea? Like if they brought in lights, because they'd have to bring in, lights.
I think that's what Goodell is envisioning. At least that's what I've read.
I mean, I'm sure the neighbors in Berea would be thrilled that the Browns would have the acreage behind the facility all lit up at 2 a.m. while they're busting out the jams and cracking the pads, right? I'm sure that'd go over well in the neighborhood there. I think I'll be honest with you. If the Browns did it, they'd probably have to do it at First Energy Stadium. That's really.
I would think so too.
Yeah, you know what I mean. Then all they'd have to do is get Baker Mayfield or Emily to turn on the lights, right?
Oh, well done, Daryl. Well done as we close up shop. All right, Daryl Ryder, our Browns beat reporter. Catch him on Twitter at Right or Wrong Fan. Also on our website, 923thefan.com. Good stuff, D. Always a pleasure. We'll do it again soon, pal. Thank you.
You got it, Chico.
How do you order food for the office these days? How do you make sure it's on time and as ordered? How can you get it individually packaged? How? Easy Cater. When you order on EasyCater.com, the food comes as ordered and on time 98% of the time. And when there's a problem, which is practically never,
thank you for calling Easy Cater.
You can reach someone in about 9 seconds. How do you order 24/7 from more than 80,000 restaurants? How? Easy Cater. Order 24/7 on EasyCater.com.
Dealing with adversity and finding ways to unify and overcome it will always be part of our future. The new season of Hope Through History, a documentary podcast presentation from C-13 Originals in association with the History Channel, written and narrated by me, John Meacham, features moments in our nation's past when we faced challenges as a country and as a world. Listen and follow season 2 of Hope Through History, available now wherever you get your podcasts.